Now, as Carlos already mentioned, I'm not a specialist of fascism, and I actually always feel a little inhibited when speaking about it, because there's so much and so much good literature on the topic. But in the early 90s of the past century, the Socialist Federation started to disintegrate, I was shocked by the shift in the political horizon, and my reaction was this was fascism. And it was a reaction towards the then dominant political and ideological orientation in Slovene politics. So I wrote a couple, a series of articles that were published in a daily newspaper which no more exists, Republika, which was a kind of mild left social democrat newspaper, and then I published this in a little booklet under the title "How Much Fascism." So it was a political intervention. It reflected embarrassment and shock, and I'm no more. I don't really agree with that position anymore, because I think it should be subtilized. This book was translated into Croatian, and people like it much better in Croatia. Boris Buller was one of those who arranged for this translation. So, my position now is that this radical right politics that resembles in certain ways fascist, classical, historical fascist politics arises in the time of crisis and combines certain elements that can be recognized as historical fascist. However, we don't have the same collage nowadays. So that's why I put the title Historical Fascisms, Neo-Fascisms and Post-Fascisms. It will be a classificatory talk, not burdened with facts and events, because we don't have time and because I'm not a specialist actually. Now, the catchword which is dominating in the media and even in the politics these days, or for some time already, is populism. So I collected some occurrences, some mentions of this term populism, and of course Orban, Viktor Orban, was one of the first whose politics was described as populist. So that's one. Orban is a standard bearer for populists in Europe. He was a liberal democrat in his early days, but now he's a populist. But Orban is not the only populist in European politics. Or in mainstream politics. Another candidate who has recently arrived to Palestine is Trump. Trumpism is a mix of populism and xenophobia, populist manifesto by Washington Post. Now the series of populist politicians, Trump, Erdogan, Farage, but also Putin. So, but that's not all. Now I like this one. Trump's and Sanders' populism. So now populism is actually starting to lose its semantic power, And this one I like particularly, it's from Croatian press. Here, high functionary of the Croatian democratic community accuses social democrats at that time of populism. Now here, social democrat accuses Croatian democratic community of populism. And here, Telegram says, well, both are populists. So, populism actually is not a term that could be useful in our debate. I was glad to find an interview by Jorge Bergoglio, the Pope Francesco, in El País. This is the original in Spanish, but you will probably, except Carlos, you'll probably better understand it in English. He says, well, that's what they call populism here. And he means Europe, or Europe and North America. It's an equivocal term because in Latin America populism has another meaning. In Latin America it means that the people, for instance people's movements, are the protagonists. They are self-organized. So it means exactly the opposite. And I was glad that a high political functionary like the Pope has this semantic sensibility and actually makes the point I was trying to make with those quotations. So we would better take a step back and speak about historical fascisms, now about neo-fascism, which is very current on periphery. And I don't think that Orban is a fascist, but the golden dawn is. Or maybe Croatian democratic community is not fascist, but it has elements, but there are far-right groupations that may be described as fascist. And this was, neo-fascism was very, very, is a kind of recognizable phenomenon on the periphery, for example, in post-socialism, but not only. In Italy, that's a current traditional trend, or in Greece. That means, or in France for that. You have it on the periphery of European Union or periphery of the core capitalist system, there are the open and neo-fascist movements. While in the center, like in European Union, I would speak about post-fascism. Post-fascism in my horizon was first introduced by a Slovene theoretician, you may know, Tonči Kuzmanić, who invented this term, proposed this term to describe Haider and the Austrian politician Haider and Italian Prime Minister at that time, Berlusconi, which means it's a political horizon that has no problem at integrating human rights, liberal values, etc., but which is also a position that invents other ways to be practical, xenophobic, chauvinist, or even racist, like Trump, for instance. One of the phenomena that are worth of attention is that it seems that a new model of politics is being formed, and that this neo-fascism, peripheral neo-fascism, and central post-fascism are kind of converging. Like 5 years ago, one could not. 5 years ago, declarations of American President Trump would be intolerable. One could not enter even a kind of larger debate with sexual chauvinism or open racism. Now it's mainstream politics. So my hypothesis would be that a new type of politics is being historically emerging, which would need new analysis and new name. And a good example, for instance, is Slovenian politics, which some of you may have followed. The present government started as a left government, as an alternative to the right wing politics of Janez Janša and Christian Democrats. That was the reason for their electoral success. They presented themselves as left. When they came to power, they profiled themselves as center, and they named the main coalition party is called the Party of the Modern Center. And now, last year, they put this sadistic fence on the border. And there was, intriguing migrants, there was Orban. Orban at least has a kind of fence that is not dangerous for people who approach it. So you have this bizarre movement of the same coalition, where there are social democrats, pensioners who are presumably left-wing, that has shifted from center-left to, well, center-right, which maybe even worse. as for historical fascisms, my main classical sources would be Zonneritten, with his analysis of economical dimension of German Nazism, and Trotsky, with his idea of dialectical approach, which means fascism is internally contradictory. It is a mass movement, a popular movement, but also an elitist political intervention of certain fractions of capital. So the historical situation is defined by the conjuncture of two heterogeneous, to a large extent, originally independent processes, the class recomposition of national bourgeoisie from a historical position of structural weakness. According to Zonneritten, that was the modernized part of German economy, which was not internationally competitive, but which has modernized itself and has metallurgy, heavy industry, which has invested large sums of capital, which were not internationally competitive. So they had to find another exit, and this exit evidently was armament industry. So it was only a fraction of capital that supported Nazism. And class decomposition of the working classes under the hegemony of bourgeois ideology, which means there must be an important disorganization of labor movement. In Germany there were two strong political organizations representing working people, social democrats and communists. But they were they couldn't find a platform for a united position, and the working classes were decomposing as class and starting to accept bourgeois or small bourgeois, petty bourgeois ideology. Now, the terms recomposition and decomposition of the class are taken from Italian operaist theory, which is, this theory is great because it makes the distinction between empirical existence of working people and their composition into a class. So It's a good solution to the old problem, do classes exist? What exists are structural elements that reproduce the system. On one side, the capital and competition between individual, among individual capitals, and then the way how capitalist class composes itself with the, to say it very fast, with the average profit rate, the material existence of capitalist class composition. On the other side, there is what operates call technical composition of labor power. This must be familiar to you, because this means that people who leave the educational system should be able to enter the labor market, which means their technical composition, their skills should reflect the present state of technology. And as long as working people adjust technical composition of the workers, they are not a class. They are just structural element of this system of domination and exploitation that reproduces itself. They can compose themselves into a class if they politicize themselves, but that's not necessary. So that's, I mean, it's a very useful theoretical tool, and also I use it here. So, neo-fascism in post-socialism has striking analogies, but in a different situation. On the side of the dominating class or ruling groups. I mean, socialism does not exist anymore, or at least not in Europe and most of the former socialist world. But the debate whether what was the class composition of this system is still going on. So, on one side, what I perceive, my hypothesis is that what happened was the rearticulation of the former ruling coalitions in socialist countries in the view of composing themselves into national bourgeoisie. And that's my hypothesis about the destruction of Yugoslavia, for instance. Ruling coalitions the main position, the coalition that really ruled, that actually ruled Yugoslavia, were Republican state party bureaucracies plus ideological bureaucracies, which means the so-called cultural elite, which had a catastrophic part in fomenting the war. They reintegrated themselves from party-state bureaucracies into a project of building up national bureaucracy. I'll show you how I see this sequence for Slovenia. Because I guess this project was, of course, doomed from the very beginning, because it was it took place in the context of globalization and composition of world capital. Gesamtkapital was no more, that's what Marx's expression, total capital, Gesamtkapital, which until 70s or 75 was national, was already in the 80s and 90s was already global. So, but nevertheless, we have this project of national bourgeoisie. And on the other way, labor movements were disorganized in several ways. In socialist system, you don't remember because you didn't live through that, but labor movement in Yugoslavia, which was a relatively democratic and self-managed society, labor movement, which spontaneous labor movement, was out of the system. So when you had workers organized strikes, there were so-called savage strikes. And it was a very interesting position, because being outside the system we had a very strong negotiating power. You know, in the 50s, if you had to strike, then you could expect violent repression, which was police. Really, violence. But in the 80s, since they were out of the system, the perception by the power holders was that they are more dangerous than they were really bad. And one of the sociologists in Slovenia, Jerošek, who later became a right-wing nationalist, but at that time was a quite good industrial sociologist, he calculated that with all the textile workers in Slovenia went on strike at the same moment, the system could not survive. It could not buy them and meet the demands. But of course, they never went on strike in the whole country. They are more or less disorganized. But of course, with the change of the political and economic system, the disorganization of labor movement was almost complete, with the exception, probably with the exception of Slovenia, who in the 90s had very strong labor trade unions, who were able in 92 to organize a general strike with 400,000 participants who stopped liberal reforms, shock therapy, sucks. So, as I said, this project of national bourgeois composition was probably doomed from the very beginning, since the pressures from the global Gesamtkapital were too strong, and the European Union was already at that time pushing in this direction against national bourgeoisies and national capitalist economies. Now the labor movements after the change of the system were disorganized in several ways, by juridical and ideological fragmentations along ethnic and religious lines, which was this fragmentation was operated by governments and ideological apparatus, churches, schools, the media. I mean, the 90s are really a dark period in post-socialist countries, where anti-communist ideologies, civil society, human rights dissidents, and all those ambiguous ideologies, which under socialism made sense, but in capitalism it's a different story. So, and of course, by the state restoration of capitalist institutions from above, market, especially the labor market. So if we compare post-socialist neo-fascism with historical fascism, is that here in Italy and Germany, for instance, there is classic composition of national bourgeoisie from a historical position of structural weakness. Italy was periphery, Germany was competing to get to the center of the system, but not the whole of its industry was able to do it. And there was class decomposition of working classes. Now, in post-socialism, there was a failed rearticulation of the former ruling coalitions into national bourgeoisie. So again, you have a bourgeois or capitalist bourgeoisie which is weak, which is non-competitive in systematic and international terms. And of course, the strong institutional pressure to destroy labor movement. Now here's my I don't know how can if you can see that's my hypothesis about Slovenia. This is what happened on the side of labor, this is what happened on the side of capital, and this is our systemic pressures exercised by international by a global capitalist system. So the 90s There is shock therapy, there is pressure by international organizations for fast privatizations, for fast introduction of liberal economics and for fast deregulation. On the side of the capital, there is a social basis for a potential national bureaucracy, national bourgeoisie, which was called by the right red directors, which means the management of successful great companies like pharmaceutical industry, like Krka or Gorenje, household small apparatuses, Maribor town, trucks, truck industry, etc. So there was a social basis, but it had no political representation. It was the social democrats who should be the representatives, were demoralized. They had the European integration project. So on the labor side, there was heritage of self-management, which means workers, the people who work still thought they were the masters of factories and the working processes, and trade unions who very fast were able to shift from this kind of anemic socialist trade unions to transform themselves into classical economist trade union position. It was nothing very radical, it was nothing very revolutionary, but it was this standard trade union economism. So, if you talk to Western European trade unionists, they would say Slovene trade unions have weak rhetorics but strong politics, while in the West, trade unions usually have radical rhetorics but weak politics. So, working class composition was still relatively strong and politically organized by the trade unions. Now, they reached in the early 90s. They reached a class compromise, which said the state will preserve public services and reduce social state. A social state which will not be as strong as in socialism, but still it would officially be social state. That was within the constitution, and public services, health, education and pensions. On the other hand, the concession was privatization and intensification of the labor process. A coalition for the accession to the European Union. The conditions to the accession were met by intensification of work, not by technological transformation. That's a common feature in most post-socialist countries, that they missed the moment of post-Fordist technological transformation in the 80s. If you look at the history of Yugoslavia, you could see that the socialist system was very able to create an industrial economy that was more or less on the level of that period, and was able to transform predominantly rural and lowly educated population into second level, which means college, professional schools, urban population. That's incredible how this changed like from 1945 to 1960. Where the problems began, but still, this for I use Fordism because it's it's stereotypic word, but you can you understand what that is. This, for this pattern became obsolete in the 70s, and if you look in different perspectives to historical processes of the 70s, you could see that around the mid 70s there was this break when certain economists were able to transform. That was called neoconservatism at that time, then Reaganism, Thatcherism, but they changed the pattern of industrial organization and of the technological pattern. The introduction of new technologies, information, communication technologies, etc. While people in Yugoslavia entertained themselves with nationalism and breaking down of the federation, they missed this historical time, a historical moment. So the only way to meet the conditions imposed by European Union for the accession in Slovenia was to intensify working process. What does that mean? That means introducing early processes of exploitation, the so-called production of absolute surplus value, which means longer working days, working on weekends, no holidays, and working more intensively. All the same bloody technology. So, but that was still good. Worse is coming. Now, we enter more or less 2004, Slovenia enters the European Union. The national bourgeois project breaks down. Trade unions are losing their power. Labor is more and more fragmented. Why? Because big factories are being closed. The big factories that are the basis of labor organization, and precarious, so-called non-standard labor contracts are being introduced. No more labor rights, but civil contracts. You are independent entrepreneur, and that you work on the same position as before. One of the labor inspectors in Slovenia once said, "Well, in some factories there are five directors serving the same machine. So they are formerly directors of their small enterprises with one employee themselves. They are workers, but formally, juridically, they are." Directors of enterprise. So, so you have a real decomposition of the working class and Comprador project. The political right introduces Comprador project. I won't go into the detail, which means dependent development. The authors, you know, the so-called dependence theory or unequal exchange theory. It started with Prebisch in early 60s. It's one of the famous books of this theory of dependent development is André Gunder Frank, Capitalism in Latin America, who launched the graduate development of underdevelopment. As you see, you are being integrated into the world capitalist system in a way that you are more you develop, more you're getting underdeveloped. So, and the class carrier of such project is Comprador bourgeoisie, which means a ruling class which serves centers of economic and political and military power outside of the country. So the right politicians came into power in 2004, they had this comprador project, but they had no social basis for it. They didn't have any managers, any really organizers of industry. Most of those people who were the economic fraction of the right-dominated politics at that time are now in jail. They were more or less people with individual idea of individual enrichment, but not not a class. So the class compromise which was formed from this double failure of labor class, of working class, and bourgeoisie was coalition for survival, which means no immediate reforms, no flat tax, but creeping reforms, non-standard labor relations, managerial privatizations, which were more or less criminal, and coalition for survival. So the present, then crisis came, managerial privatizations failed, and what we have now is disintegrated labor, trade unions who now promote social partnership. That was the, it was a very intelligent way of recuperation of integration of labor movement. The government created social economic council, which is actually the Politburo of the climate capitalism now. Everything is decided there, not in the parliament, but in a council where trade unions and chamber of commerce meet with government as a mediator, more or less. So, dependent integration into Euro-Atlantic ruling class is the elite project, and political managerial bureaucracy is the social basis of this project. So, but of course we have a parliamentary left party who is very radical, even though it's actually social democrat. So, now I come to the post-fascism, which is this new formation, which actually probably started in European Union in Brussels, in the bureaucratic circles of European Union, the development of classical fascism is being contained, is being controlled by performing its the same functions by the means of liberal state of law and introducing innovative juridical, political, and economic arrangements. I won't go into detail, but you have all those bizarre arrangements. For instance, when Slovenian banks failed, the state, of course, saved them. But the Commission imposed very severe conditions upon this state, government saving of the banks, like diminishing of the capital, like only approving credits that bring 8% of 8% of capital. 8% of
interest.
Yes, sorry. Which is practically impossible. So basically the conditions were preparing Slovene banks for being sold to big multinational financial organizations. And for instance, now there is a conflict with the European Commission about a criminal investigation of the Slovene National Bank. Police is investigating in a criminal investigation the dealings of the management of Slovene National Bank, and the European Central Bank and European Commission are trying to prevent it because these are secret documents of European Central Bank, which is very interesting. That you have a you know, in Slovenia they are articulating this conflict as a question of national sovereignty, which of course is a little. And in the European Union, your sovereignty is limited. It's pressure doctrine. It's another doctrine that was first promoted by the Soviet Union. But if it is a criminal investigation, I think a better argument is that it's a criminal affair. You cannot obstruct the law. So anyway, let me only show you, because I will end now. Those two schemata. Now this is why peripheral or post-socialist countries are periphery, and why are they lagging behind and probably have missed the decisive historical moment when they should have restructured, but entered instead into the process of so-called transition, which means dependent development. This is my scheme of classical capitalism, which is also valid for this capitalism, which means national economies. The defining structural feature is separation of the labor power from means of production and organization of production process. So we have labor power here, you have management as a representative of capital, that controls means of production and organization of product process, and then the product comes to the market of the products. And here you have market of labor power. Now I introduce a new concept on the basis of Italian or Paris, which I call social composition of labor power, which means the whole social mass of working people should be composed in such a way as to correspond to the technology and the way of organization of productive processes in a national economy. And the trend in this historical situation, which is basically after 1945, is a general tendency towards homogenization. What that means? Labor rights are a state affair, and the labor legislation homogenizes the field of labor contracts. Also, labor processes and the organization of labor productive processes is more or less homogeneous. So you have a strong tendency towards homogenization of society, and the basic unit of reproduction, which is household, has homogeneous income, has a long-term perspective, and such a society, which is becoming more and more homogeneous, the inequalities are being reduced, etc., is ideologically cemented by national culture. Now, with this break in the late 70s and early 80s, what happens is that there is a heterogenization of organization of production and means of production, and you got a whole spectrum of different relations. You know, you have the classical labor power, which is defined by this separation between means of production, organization of production processes, and the labor power. But then you have, for instance, also a small subcontractor who is like designer. He owns his means of, or her means of production. She is free to organize her labor process as she wants, but her product is already sold to a bigger company because she or he are producing computer programs for them, or marketing models, etc. Or you may have a whole enterprise, big enterprise, in a national economy, like Mura Textile in Slovenia, who who is a classical capitalist enterprise company with labor power management, and they own their product, but they don't control the marketing of their product, which is global. And they are actually a part of boss of international textile company, who has no responsibility for the who is the only buyer of their product, but has no responsibility to buy it when it's produced. This is called monopsony in economics, which means when boss cannot stand the competition of Pakistan and China in textiles, they cut down certain production lines and they destroy this big factory in Slovenia. So, what happens in globalized economy is that to the defining separation of capitalist system, there is added a second separation of the whole productive process and the marketing of those products. So what happens is that whole production processes are in competition with each other under the conditions of incomplete information. For instance, if Renault says to Renault has a factory in Slovenia, which is heavily subsidized by the government. So if Renault says we are going to delocalize this this factory if you don't introduce precarious labor relations and if you don't give us a certain subsidy, the government of Slovenia or the company that subcontracts in Slovenia does not really know whether this threat is realistic or not. They don't know whether in Romania there are facilities that could support delocalization, or maybe in Pakistan or in China. And for instance, when there was a big strike in Gorenje, the director said, well, if you are if you're not stopping this strike, we'll delocalize the production, we'll go to Turkey. And then this an industrial sociologist, Stanojevic, said, well, he's bluffing. He cannot do that because this Gorenje factory is so integrated into its context, not only economically, but also in the terms of skills, in the terms of education of the workers, in the terms of of the possibility of generational change, etc., that he cannot, he would need at least 5 to 10 years to create those conditions in Turkey. So he's bluffing. But of course, in this particular case, this sociologist knew about this labor process. Mostly workers don't really know whether the threat is realistic or not. So you're under this blackmail all the time. Now let me, or maybe we could reserve this for discussion. I only give the final why those analogies? When you have, these are Kondratiev long-term cycles of capitalist economy. And when you have a depression, there is a chance that you get fascism or fascist-like politics. And they first occur on the periphery, like historical fascisms. First in Italy in the early 1920s, and then they creep into the center of Europe. Post or neo-fascism, first in Yugoslavia, first in Ukraine, and then they creep into France and Netherlands or Germany. So when this line starts going down, you could look to the periphery and probably find radical right-wing politics. And the fact that we have this fascist politics now in Europe, in the center of Europe, in the West Europe, and even in the United States, what does it mean? It means that this last contractive cycle is going down, and that the Euro-Atlantic core of capitalistic economy is weakening. Pacific, East Asia, they're the future. So, look, retroactively everything seems very deterministic. But it's retroactive wisdom, and it could have been changed. Okay, thank you.